respected ulama, my respected elders, my brothers and my sisters and my little ones, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. After praising the Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and sending salutations on Nabiya Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I begin first of all by thanking you, the people of London, and especially Mulana Ismail, the founder of the Azhar Academy, for inviting me and giving me this opportunity to convey the message of Allah and His Messenger Muhammad Rasulullah salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi. And I pray to the Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that Allah accepts these efforts of yours in listening to this message and thereafter acting upon this message. As I pray to the Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepts these efforts of mine tonight. The title allocated for today was Our Pious Predecessors, Their Sacrifices, and Their Devotion to Islam. And what a beautiful title it was indeed. However, as soon as I was allocated this title, I immediately felt that I would not be able to do justice to such a short time, to such a great title in such a short time. Why? Because our pious predecessors were not like people that were considered great in other religions, cultures, or societies, in which you just have a handful of people who stand tall, a cut above the rest, and whose biographies, whose sacrifices, and whose achievements can be summarized with ease without any difficulty. Our pious predecessors, the people that we belong to, their sacrifices, their commitments, their devotion to Islam, and their achievements, I should say outstanding achievements, whether in the Islamic sciences or the worldly sciences, were remarkable. And they number hundreds and thousands in each era, and thus are worthy that they be mentioned in tonight's lecture. Look at every Sahabi, every companion of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and you will find that the sacrifice that he made, the human mind cannot comprehend. The likes of Abu Bakr, the likes of Umar, the likes of Uthman and Ali, Talha, Zubair, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, Abdullah ibn Abbas, Abdullah ibn Umar, Sa'd ibn Waqqas, Abdurrahman ibn Auf. You name them one by one. And if you pick up works written on these individuals, you will not be able to comprehend the sacrifices that they made for Islam. Open the works written on the Tabi'een, those that succeeded the Sahaba, those that came after the Sahaba, and you will find that every Tabi'i is worthy of this, that he get a mention in tonight's lecture. Then came the Atba'u Tabi'een, those that came after the Tabi'een. Every one of them is worthy of mention. Look at the Fuqaha, the jurists of Islam, and the things that they contributed towards Islam. Everyone is worthy of mention. We have the great Imam Abu Hanifa. We have the great Imam Shafi'i, Imam Malik, Imam Muhammad, Imam Ahmad, Imam Zufar, Imam Abu Yusuf. Name them one by one. Who can forget the Muhaddithin, the masters of Hadith? Everyone worthy of mention. Again, Imam Bukhari, Imam Muslim, Imam Tirmizi, Imam Nasai, Abu Dawud, Ibn Majah, Darami, Bayhaqi, Malik, Ahmad, Abu Awana, Abdul Razzaq, Ibn Abi Shayba, the works of Suyuti, the works of Aini, the works of Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani, the works of Kastalani. Name them one by one, and you will find that the contribution that they made towards Islam was remarkable. Who at the same time can forget the Mufassirin, the commentators of the Quran, the Ibn Kathir, the Qurtubis, the Ibn al-Arabis? Who can forget the historians, the Mu'arrikhin? Who can forget the Mujahideen, Salahuddin al-Ayyubi, Muhammad bin Qasim, Tariq bin Ziyad? Never mind them. Recently, Hazrat Shaykh Rahmatullah Alayh, Mawlana Ilyas Rahmatullah Alayh, and the effort that they put and the sacrifices they made for Islam and their devotion again was remarkable. And every one of these people are worthy of mention in today's lecture. Now, who does one include in a lecture like this? And whose name, whose mention does one leave in a lecture like this? Thus, to make it easy for myself, I chose from amongst them the one whose devotion and sacrifices after Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam equal none other. The one whose sacrifices and devotion can be seen in the words of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, لو وزن إيمان أبي بكر بإيمان أهل الأرض لرجح بهم. That if the iman and the belief of all the inhabitants of the dunya was placed in one pan of the balance, and just the iman of Abu Bakr and the belief of Abu Bakr was placed in the second pan of the balance, such was the iman of Abu Bakr that it would outweigh the iman of all the inhabitants of the dunya. The one who's just one good deed would outweigh all the good deeds of Umar Farooq radiallahu ta'ala an. Yet as Umar Farooq radiallahu ta'ala an was no ordinary person. Abu Ya'la Tabrani recorded a hadith on the authority of Ammar ibn Yasir radiallahu ta'ala an. He relates that Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to me on one occasion, O Ammar, Sayyidina Jibreel has just come to me, and I asked Jibreel, O Jibreel, حدثني بفضائل عمر في السماء. O Jibreel, relate to me the virtues of Umar in the heavens. And Sayyidina Jibreel alayhi salatu wa salam informed me, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, لو حدثتك بفضائل عمر منذ ما لبث نوح في قومه ألف سنة إلا خمسين عاما ما نفذت. That if I was to relate to you continuously the virtues of Umar for the same amount of period that Sayyidina Nuh alayhi salatu wa salam conveyed the message of Allah for 950 years, even then the virtues of Umar in the heavens will not come to an end. And remember, wa inna Umar la hasanatun min hasanati Abi Bakr, that Umar is only one good deed out of the good deeds of Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala an. I chose from amongst them the one who always came second after Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I ask, was he not the second to believe in the Almighty Allah after Nabi Kareem sallallahu